maybe a relative you wanted to encourage, but you're afraid of kind of ruining it. Maybe a neighbor you've been working on for a while and you're just waiting for that, but if you say the wrong thing, maybe you won't worry about it anymore. Or maybe somebody like my 13-year-old redhead, someone who knew no hope, no God, no nothing. She had nothing in her life. Her and her parents lived above a bar, and on the bottom floor was this bar that the parents owned, but I think spent more time drinking than actually serving. In fact, quite often this girl would have to go and pass out the drinks while her parents were passed out. And her parents fought a lot, and her parents drank a lot, and her parents talked about divorce a lot. And this one day that her and I were talking, she was afraid of the sad thing is, I can't remember her name. I can remember her freckles on her face. I can remember her red hair. And I can remember the tears streaming down her face. He thought my parents did the voice. Who's going to love me?
Yes.
Who's going to take care of me? If that's not an opening to talk about Jesus, I don't know what it is, right? I mean, there it is, right there. And yet, am I going to talk to her? Well, I witnessed it. Yes, my 8th grade teacher had given me an assignment. He was former Marine Corps. He understood what it is to say fear and say go get him. So he sent his little 8th grade boys and girls and went to go get him. And yet, out of that class of 13 kids, only 2 people turned in a paper. What's so scary about witnessing? What's so fearful that it gets our palms sweaty, gets our hearts pounding, gets us thinking there's space tonight? Have you ever felt that way? Have you ever doubted your own abilities, your own skills, your own timing? Certainly. It almost seems natural to the human condition. And if that's so, if you've ever been in that moment like I did, staring down a 13-year-old redhead, and do I have a story for you? Do I have a story for you about God handling fear? About God addressing concerns? About God saying, here, I'm going to help you. Even though you don't seem to be there. The story that we have today, in Jesus working with his disciples, is in very much a similar moment. And how they move through fear. Jesus has spent 40 days after his resurrection working with these guys, teaching them, empowering them. But the problem has been they're not really getting the lesson. They're not really learning what the teacher is repeating to them. Even on the 40th day when Christ ascends into heaven, they still don't seem to get it. In fact, it's helpful to me if I think about it. Jesus keeps showing up to his disciples, and Jesus keeps showing up to his disciples, and they keep listening. The first time he meets with them, Easter Sunday night, he tells them, don't be afraid. Have no fear. The next week, he comes up to them, don't be afraid. Have no fear. Peace be with you. He tells them to go out and to bring this message of forgiveness. Twice he meets with them all. You know the next time in Scripture, the third time Jesus meets with his disciples, you know what they're doing? They're fishing. Not exactly the Lord's work. But Jesus is taking time to sit down and mentor and disciple them for 3 years. He showed up in their midst of fears when they're kind of in a doomsday bunker mentality. The boys are out fishing. I mean, Jesus would probably be angry at this point. You would think Jesus would say, get out of the boat and get back into school, but no. Jesus goes to the boat. He helps them catch fish. Now, when he and Peter are sitting down the side enjoying the meal, he's telling them, hey, again, feed my sheep. Do these things. And then when we get to the fourth appearance, his ascension. Go and make disciples. Go and do these things. Preach this message. But you know what's lost in Scripture from his resurrection 50 days later? You know what's not recorded at all? they don't seem to get. I mean, what would you do if someone hadn't completed their work in 50 days? If you got a guy that cuts your lawn, are you going to let him go 50 days without cutting? No, you're going to give him your lawn. If you got a boss that pays you, are you going to let him go 50 days without giving him a paycheck? No, you're going to duck the HR. If you've got a grocery store you like to go to and they're out of milk, you're going to wait 50 days before they have milk again? No, you're going to get, 50 days is too long. You might be patient with 2, 3, or 5. But 50 is just way too long for someone not to get it done. And that's essentially what's happening here. Time after time, he is preaching, he is teaching, and yet they choose to say, we're going to stay with you. We're going to find excuses why. Even when you come to us and you catch us when we're fishing, no, boys, you're not getting it. No, boys, you seem to be missing. You see how controlled they can be with fear. You see how weak that can be when you suddenly think about all the reasons not to. These boys, they were very good at getting their assignments complete, not so much at getting God's assignments. And I wonder for us if that's true too. I wonder if us, with our busy day-to-day lives, who are we more focused on getting done? God's assignments? Or my assignments? I mean, you certainly have assignments for yourself, and they may be as simple as groceries, laundry and grass cutting. But you have them. You want them. But God also has assignments as well. He tells us to go and spread the message. He tells us to live every day like it would be our last of judgment. He tells us to live as Christ has called us to be. That's God's assignment. And while it doesn't come from a Marine corporal, it is still rather important as it comes from the Lord most high. And yet, as you think about your week, God's mind, which one do you get? Is it about the energy and effort you put in Monday through Saturday? Whose gets completed? Got that girl at Walgreens you've been thinking about talking to? About Jesus. Did you open up this time? Got that devotional book that's sitting on the event stand? Got that app on your phone? You got that prayer you've been wanting to pray for evangelism? But Netflix is so interesting. But family time, but there's a barbecue somewhere, but there's live music. Hey, there's a Predators game. There is a lot of things for us to do. But who's the silence getting done? God. Well, this disciple looks back at his last week. When he thinks about me, what's his time? Maybe this disciple is like you. I was mommy. Making sure I get my checklist of stuff done in the yard. Making sure I get my things I want with my family and my friends. And then the work of the Lord seems to be something he doesn't want to set for me. We may literally be fishing like the disciples did, or maybe something else. But too often in our sinful, myopic view, it's about what I want, and I'll get to God a little bit later. I mean, we like to use words like fear and training and skill. But really, the question is it what God wants, or is it what I want to do? What a joy as Christians that we get to sing that song just sing. When we recognize our sin, when we realize our misplaced priorities, and we get to sing that psalm as we come into God's house. Come, Holy Spirit, we sing. Renew our hearts and kindle in us the fire of God. God, I got my priorities wrong. God, I'm living my life the wrong way. God, I'm too concerned about my will instead of your will. That's sins to confess were renewed by this cross. And as we get to come to that, as we come to God in His house, we come and say, again, Lord, I'm sorry. Again, Lord, I've changed that for everything. Again, Lord, I come to you now. I see that the cross is empty. You are my son. You took the punishment for me. So quickly I focus on what I want. Oh, this is what you want. This is God's mission for you. This is what you do for me. This is how much you love me. This is how much you care for me. But you let nothing in your life get in the way of God's mission, which is God's assignment, which is saving you. Sometimes I neglect that. Sometimes I rush through that. Sometimes I don't think about that. But this cross removes me because it's empty. Because you're not on it. Yes, you suffered. Yes, you died. The cross is empty, but below it, the cup is full. Here in your very body, but you went off with you. Forgiveness is sin. Assurance of comfort and joy. And my God does love me. He does care about me. Even with all the mistakes I made, even with the energy wasted, even with all the time I spent on YouTube this week, that was very fruitless. God, you still love me. God, you still feed me. God, you still remind me that I'm renewed in you, because I don't find that comfort in anything else. Even as much as I need. Renew me, Lord, with an empty cross and a full cup and food prepared for the forgiveness. And after you renew with that message of forgiveness, now, kindle in me. To say it another way, start a fire in me. Start a fire in my heart to give me the power to do the things you call me. That's why we are ready. But why we have bread today. There is a fire. That great cat disciples hid in their rooms, went out fishing instead of doing the Lord's work. 50 days after Christ's resurrection, the fire comes. That even as these men sequestered yet again, fire comes. God brings fire from heaven and advances on our hands. God brings fire from heaven and enlightens their hearts so they speak in these languages, so they speak the wonders of God in all of these languages. So they tell people exactly what He has done. For these praying cat disciples, God brings fire. God brings it then. And God gives them opportunity. He doesn't give them the power when nobody's around. He gives it when Jerusalem is packed for the pilgrim festival. God wants us to accomplish His assignment, and He provides the means, and He provides the opportunity to do it. And of all the guys to witness at Pentecost, of all the guys that be filled with the Spirit, Peter starts talking. Peter, the man who denies the Lord, the man who's impetuous, the man who makes a whole lot of bad choices in the Bible. Peter becomes the first preacher of these post-Christ disciples. And what does he talk about? The sermon that leads so many people to Christ. What does he say? Well, Christ suffered. Christ died. Christ rose. Christ ascended. It's all about Christ. This weak, mean guy no longer focuses on him, what he can or can't do. Peter says this is what Christ is doing. And to end this sermon, as we ended our lesson, this kind of comment, everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. It's great comfort in that word, will. Not maybe, not could be, not if you do the right thing. Call on the name of the Lord will be saved. Peter preaches a message of full and free forgiveness, that faith trusts. It's not about me. It's not about how powerful, or how smart, or how good I am. Call on the Lord. You'll be saved. What a powerful message for praying at the center. What a powerful message for people who find themselves fishing a little bit too often. What a powerful message for you and I who doubt our own ability. Who look at someone, whether they're 13 years old, or 35 years old, or 55, and think, I want to talk to them, but I'm not like a pastor, and I don't have a lot of training in this, and this might be my first time. All the things that run doctors. We live in Middle Tennessee. There's how many people come into our communities every day. This place is packed, and not just downtown during the writers' day. This place is packed with people who need to hear about Jesus, and God brings them to us, not just for a pilgrim festival. He brings them to live, to work, to move in next to Jesus. God brings these people to witness. And God gives us his fire. Maybe not an outward thing dancing on your head, but the fire of his spirit that uses the most powerful weapon this world has ever seen. His word that breaks down this stubborn heart a lot and shows you how to live. His word that has shown you how much Jesus done and will do for you. This word that works on them too. Yeah, they may heckle and jeer. You may call people drunk, no matter. Peter didn't stop. Peter didn't let the hecklers throw him off base. No, he knew what the Spirit was doing. He knew what the Spirit had brought. And he kept preaching. He knew what God's assignment was, and he looked at people differently when he wanted to go. Look for the 13-year-old redhead in your life. Look for the person in your life who is broken, who is weak, who needs Jesus. It's probably you or something, right? But there's somebody else as well. Because there is no greater feeling I have found in this life than being able to bring this. There's no greater feeling as someone sits across the table from you crying about the pending divorce, they did divorce, of her parents. Jesus has got you. Jesus has got you. Why don't you come to this church together? Why don't you listen to this pastor? I'd like to hear. Why don't you sit down and talk about what God is? I know you don't feel like you got it right now. Believe me, I don't have a lot either. God's so loving, you call on his name, and you will be saved. I don't remember your name. I don't remember your parents' name. I don't remember her house. But I remember the moment after I got to witness for the first time, after Maureen assigned it to me. I'm thankful for that. I'm thankful that Maureen pushed my 13-year-old butt into something I wasn't quite comfortable with. But God gave me the mercy. God gave me the opportunity. God gave me the person. And God does the same for you. God gives you the words to say. God gives you the opportunity with your relation, with your neighbors, with your friends. And God gives you this power. Working through this word. Will your hands be clammy? Will your heart race? Will your lips quiver? I still do. I do this for a living. That's okay. I should be allowed to listen. But it's not about me. So often I think it's about me. It's not about me. It's not about you. It's about this message that everyone who calls in the name of the Lord will be saved. It works on a crying 13-year-old redhead. It works on me. It'll work on your neighbor, your co-worker, and friend as well. Witness the renewing of Christ through the empty cross and the full cup. And witness to the guy next to you with all this mess. Amen. Please stand. May the peace of God which transcends